8 to 11. So otherwise you can even look on the screen. Then God said to Noah and to his sons with him, I now establish my covenant with you and with your descendants after you and with every living creature that was with you, the birds, the livestock, and all the wild animals, all those that came out of the ark with you, every living creature on earth, I establish my covenant with you. Never again will all life be destroyed by the waters of a flood. Never again will there be a flood to destroy the earth. So let's look to God in prayer. Our Father, we thank you for this evening. Lord, open our eyes by the Spirit to see the truth of your word for our spiritual nourishment. And we might also behold the wonderful things from this passage. We ask all these things in the precious name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Friends, there are so many treaties, agreements, partnerships in our today's world. So some of the most five important treaties in the world history we can see on the screen. And there's a NATO. This is a North Atlantic Treaty Organization. This protects an alliance between 29 North American and European countries. And next comes the United Nations. There are currently 193 members, and they have more than 560 multilateral treaties which cover broad range of subject matters such as human rights, disarmament, protection of the environment. In addition to all this, there are business contracts and also marriage partnerships and job agreements, etc., etc. All these kinds of examples are pretty binding. Today, we are going to talk about a similar word by name, God's covenant. This covenant also is a binding, a contract between two or more parties. But unlike other secular agreements, we see God's covenant is of pure grace because it is one-sided and no strings are attached. And interestingly, this God's covenant never be revoked, and it still applies for us today. For more details, let's move into our lesson. So here is our outline: the aftermath of the judgment, that is the chapter 8, and second division, the renewal of mankind, that is chapter 9. Chapter 9 from verse 1 to 17. The aftermath of judgment, the renewal of mankind. Last week, we have seen the onslaught of the flood, and we have recounted the first days of the flood. And for many months now, Noah and his family have been in the ark, and that's where we find them in our verse 1. But God remembered Noah and all the wild animals and the livestock that were with him in the ark. So chapter 8 opens with God remembering Noah. When the scripture says that God remembers, it is not that God forgot and now suddenly remembers something. No. Remember, this points to God's faithfulness. God will act in his time. And also note, not just Noah. God remembered Noah and the animals too. Friend, we can certainly draw comfort from this. In his eye, if his eye is on the sparrow, then his eyes is certainly on you as well, because you are worth more than many sparrows. Now, God remembered. God remembered is the cause for the reversal of the flood. So Noah was remembered by God in three ways. Number one, he caused the waters to recede. Number two, he gave a sign where Noah sent out a dove. And number three, he commanded to leave the ark. So now, yes. So God remembered Noah. So God remembered Noah. So what happens? What does God do? God, he sent a wind over the earth and the waters receded. God sent a wind that blew across the whole earth and caused the floodwaters to begin to recede. Just as the Spirit hovered over the formless waters, that what we have seen in chapter 1. Here the Spirit is pushing the waters away for a new beginning of life. Now, the springs of the deep and the floodgates of the heavens had been closed. The waters continued to recede until the 10th month. And on the first day of the 10th month, the tops of the mountains became visible. Then he stopped off the springs of the deep and closed the floodgates of the heavens. And his mighty word to command the seas to go back to their borders. Friends, this speaks to God's authority over the forces of nature. He commanded the wind and the wind blew. He commanded the waters. At his command, the water levels began to decrease around the globe. Now, after 40 days, Noah opened a window. And opened a window he had made in the ark. Noah was looking for signs that flood was coming to an end. Noah was very patient during these times. It was after another 40 days, he tested to see if the ground was dry enough to come out of the ark. So with sure, By this time, he was tired of being around those animals day and night. Verse 7, and sent out a raven, and it kept flying back and forth until the waters has dried up from the earth. So Noah sent out a raven. Since ravens feast on a rotting flesh, it no doubt found plenty to eat on the surface of the ocean. It flew back and forth, but did not return to the ark. And verse 8, then he sent out a dove to see if the water has receded from the surface of the ground. The first time Noah sent out a dove to see if it was safe to leave the ark. But the dove could not find nowhere to perch because there was water over all the surface of the earth. So it came back because the water was not low enough. And so he returned to Noah in the ark. Now, you see, Noah reached out his hand and took the dove and brought it back to himself in the ark. Friends, here is a beautiful picture of God's grace. That dove found no resting place. This is a picture of us in the world. There is no place for us, but God has reached out and taken us back into the ark, his place of safety in a world of chaos and destruction. Friend, that ark is Jesus Christ. We should rejoice every day of our lives. Do you? Next, look at verse 11. When the dove returned to him in the evening. When the dove returned to him in the evening, there in its beak was a freshly plucked olive leaf. Then Noah knew that water has receded from the earth. Friends, this was an exciting development. There is even the exclamation mark at the end of the verse 11. Did you notice? The second time the dove returned with an olive leaf indicating that plants were beginning to grow. Friend, are you familiar with the dove and olive branch symbol? It is a symbol for peace. Sometimes we see in the treaties, they are extending olive branches. The symbol comes from this story. It symbolizes the peace restored between God and mankind. It also symbolized that peace has come to the earth and evil has been eradicated. Next, he waited 7 more days. He waited 7 more days and sent the dove out again, but this time it did not return to him. The third time, Noah waited another week, and this time when he sent the dove out, it did not come back at all. Noah knew then that the end of the flood must be very near. Verse 13 and 14. By the first day of the first month of Noah's 601st year, the water had dried up from the earth. And verse 14, by the 27th day of the second month, the earth was completely dry. Friends, before we get to the rest of the lesson, here we need to stop and understand some of those details the author is trying to put into our minds, like days, months, and years, because the Lord wants us to know what happened and how it happened, step by step. So here is the brief summary of these details. You see, in chapter 7, Noah entered the ark. He was 600 years, 2 months, and 17 days old. And in the present chapter, verse 14, Noah left the ark. At the time, he was 701 years, 2 months, 27 days old. So what is the timeline between these two events? 7 days later, the rain began to fall. The rain fell for 40 days and 40 nights. The flood covered the earth for 150 days. 74 days later, the top of the mountains became visible. 40 days later, Noah sent out a raven, then sent out a dove on 3 occasions. 2 weeks later, he saw dry land, and Noah stayed in the ark another 57 days until the Lord told him to leave. So if you add it all up, 382 days, Noah spent 1 year 17 days in the ark. So that is a long time. Noah was in the waiting room. He did not know when. Noah was in the waiting room. He did not know where they would ever leave the ark, but he kept going. Fact is, Noah continued to trust God and faithfully tend his duties. Friend, the waiting room is a hard place to be, but that is often where God places us. There are many waiting rooms. Friends, here are few. When we hear the words like tumor or cancer or any number of other frightening diagnoses like COVID, you must wait to see what happens. Or sometimes when you need to make a career decisions but don't know which way to turn, you often find yourselves in the waiting rooms. Or sometimes when you know God wants you to serve him, but you don't know how and where you take a seat in the waiting room. Friend, if God has allowed difficulty and hardships into our life, be like Noah and wait upon him patiently and obediently. Isaiah 49, 14 to 15 says, can a woman forget her nursing child and have no compassion on the son of her womb? Even these may forget, but I will not forget you. Friends, God remembers his children. Even when he seems to have forgotten us, we, his children, can rest on his faithful word and obediently remember him. Then God said to Noah, come out. Then, verse 15, God said to Noah, come out of the ark, you and your wife and your sons and their wives. Finally, after more than a year on the ark, God spoke again and told Noah to come out of the ark. But friends, what God has, when the God closes the door, nobody can open. When God opens the door, nobody can close it. So God shut Noah in. God must bring Noah out by his command. Noah kept waiting on God, even when God was apparently silent. Friends, obedience during the silent times is best guarantee that you will obey God. Now, verse 17, bring out every kind of living creature that is with you, the birds, the animals, and all the creatures that move along the ground, so they can multiply on earth and be fruitful and increase in number on it. So God also renewed the blessings he made at the creation. Now look at the verse 18 to 19. So Noah comes up together with his sons and his wife and his sons' wives, all the animals and all the creatures that move along the ground and all the birds. Friends, this is a momentous event. The survivors of the flood are revealed, and here they are, alive, after 1 year on the ark, coming out one after another. This is like a picture of the resurrection, of life entering new earth, purified by the flood. Next, Noah remembered the Lord. So far, we saw God remembered Noah. Now, we also see Noah's remembrance of God. Verse 20, then Noah built an altar to the Lord, and taking some of all the clean animals and clean birds, he sacrificed burnt offering on it. Once Noah got off the ark, he made an altar and sacrificed burnt offerings upon it. Friend, would you think that Noah had 1,000 other things to do? Noah would have been a busy man. Once he set foot on the dry ground again, he had to build a home for his family. They had to tend the domestic animals, and they have to move everything off the ark to their new homes. And yet Noah took time to remember the Lord by building an altar and offering sacrifice. Friends, like Noah, most of us have million other pressing things we could be doing with our time. It is so easy to get busy with life and forget the Lord and his blessings to us. Forgetting, we grow ungrateful, and ungratefulness leads away from God. So we must guard against thankless hearts by regularly setting aside a special time in our busy schedules to remember the Lord and the great salvation he has granted us. Since God in faithfulness has remembered us, we by faith must remember him too. Now, in verses 21-22, the Lord smelled the pleasing aroma and said in his heart that he will not strike down every living creature on the earth again. While the earth remains, there will be day and night, summer and winter, and it will not stop. So God reestablished all of the cycles of life that were interrupted by the flood. The Lord smelled the pleasing aroma and said in his heart. And we are told the Lord smelled the sacrifice and it was a pleasing aroma. Friend, Paul says about the sacrifice of Christ in verses 5:2, Christ loved us and gave himself up for us as a fragrant offering and sacrifice to God. Do you hear the similarity? Christ is a pleasing aroma, a fragrant offering to God. The underlying message is that the only way for sinful Noah to approach God is through the shedding of blood, because atonement must be made for sin. The only atoning sacrifice acceptable to God is the sacrifice of his one and only Son. Noah's sacrifice finds fulfillment in Christ, and Noah's sacrifice points forward to Christ. Friends, like Noah, our only path to God is through the pleasing aroma of Christ's sacrifice. So here is our first principle. The Lord's saving work on our behalf evokes a response of worship. The Lord's saving work on our behalf evokes a response of worship. So, we are beloved in Christ. In this division, we learned that Lord's saving work on our behalf always evokes the response of worship. God cared enough about you that he came in person to rescue you. The Lord never fails to fulfill his promises. Friend, whatever your situation, God promises her yes for you in Christ. Do you need to know that your sins are forgiven? God says yes in Christ. Do you need assurance that you are God's child? God says yes in Christ. Do you need peace in your heart? God says yes in Christ. Remember, God is faithful to his promise. Now let's move into our second division. The renewal of mankind. After the receding of the flood waters, until the land returns, God now makes some important covenant promises. Now, we can organize our division into 3 points. Number one, the covenant commands. Number two, the covenant promise. Number three, the covenant sign. So, let us start by looking at the covenant commands. We quickly notice there are 2 positive commands and 2 negative commands. And our scripture reading begins with the first command, that is, be fruitful. The God blesses Noah and his son, saying to them, be fruitful and increase in number and fill the earth. Notice, this is the same as what God said to Adam. It is a repetition of creation promise. It is a new beginning in a changed world. God had acted to protect man in a new environment. And the second covenant command, on every creature that moves along the ground and on all the fish in the sea, they are given into your hands. So the second command is implied rather than stated. Notice what God says to Noah about the animals, the birds, the creatures and fish. He says, they are given into your hands. In other words, Noah, like Adam, was given a dominion over them and was called to rule them. The fear and the dread of you will fall on the beasts of the earth. However, because of sin, there are some crucial differences here between Adam and Noah. Unlike Adam's time, by Noah's time, the benevolent rule had been changed so that the animals, birds, and fish experienced fear and dread at the presence of man. Next, there is an expanded diet in verses 2 to 3. God added animals to the human diet. This is the difference in pre and post flood life. Next, third command. Listen now, verses 3 and 4. The third covenant command. Everything that lives and moves about will be food for you. Just as I gave you the green plants, I now give you everything. So here the pattern is the same as the one we saw in the Garden of Eden. It starts with a generous provision. God said to Adam, you are free to eat from any tree in the garden. God said to Noah, everything that lives and moves will be good for you. But it is followed by a single prohibition. God said to Adam, but you must not eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Now, God said to Noah, but you must not eat meat that has its life blood still in it. Next, fourth command. This is followed by the fourth covenant command, a prohibition against taking another person's life. Why? God tells Noah that human life is precious because it is made in the image of God. And for your blood, I will surely demand an accounting. I will demand an accounting from every animal and from each human being too. I will demand an accounting for the life of another human being. In fact, the prohibition even extends to the animal. I will demand an accounting from every animal. And God announced 3 times that he will demand an accounting for taking the human life from both man and animal. Friends, look at the word accounting. It is very interesting. It means to inquire, investigate, or search carefully. So in God's eyes, the shedding of human blood and taking the human life requires due diligence. So note in verse 6, no, the consequences once God's investigation is done. Whoever sheds the blood of man shall his blood be shed. Do you hear what God is actually saying here? God orders the death penalty for those who murder other human beings. God wants to send a warning that sinful and violent man must not shed the blood and end the life of the one of his image bearers. Friends, do you know what this implies? This implies the rule of the law. After all, man is not to take the law into his own hands. Rather, it is to be enforced by the authorities God has established. Now, the covenant promise. Now, in verse 15, God says, he will never again destroy the earth with a flood. Notice exactly what God does. God promises that never again will the waters become a flood to destroy all life. But remember what he has said in chapter 8. Never again will the waters become a flood to destroy all life as long as the earth endures. As long as the earth endures, 2 Peter says, by the same word, the present heavens and the earth are reserved for fire, being kept for the day of judgment and destruction of the ungodly. We all should know that the earth will not endure forever. In fact, there will come a day when God will destroy the earth at the end of the time with a fire. Friend, are you ready for that word? Or are you happy with your present life? Now, I want to notice that the covenant promises, not just for Noah and his family, rather than it is cosmic and universal. In verses 10 to 12, tells us three times it is with every living creatures. And verses 15 and 16 both mention all living creatures. And verses 11, 15 and 7 specify all life. Friends, here we see another instance of God's common grace. A common grace that includes you, me, every other person, and every living creatures, whether or not they repent and believe. Like the covenant of grace God established in the Garden of Eden, this covenant with Noah and all other creatures is unconditional. God does not demand anything from Noah as a condition for his promise. The covenant is unconditional because God knows man is unable to keep any covenant. The covenant is unconditional because God knows sinful man cannot keep his command. So God, out of grace, takes it upon himself to establish the covenant apart from anything man does and tries. Next, the covenant sign. As a sign of the covenant, God set a rainbow in the clouds. But did you notice to whom the rainbow is a sign? It is not a sign for man. It is not intended to help man remember God's covenant mercies. God put the rainbow in the sky as a sign to himself. Listen to what he says in verse 14 and 15. Whenever I bring the clouds over the earth and the rainbow appears in the clouds, I will remember my covenant between me and you and all living creatures of every kind. Whenever the rainbow appears in the clouds, verse 16, I will see it and remember the everlasting covenant between God and living and all living creatures. Did you hear what God says? I will remember. I will see it and remember. So the rainbow as a sign is for God's benefit. And verse 17. So God said to Noah, this is the sign of the covenant I have established between me and all the life on the earth. Friends, let's give a serious thought here. In chapter 6, verse 17, I will establish my covenant with you. Notice, I will establish, the future tense. God said that before Noah entered the ark. And chapter 9, verse 9, I now establish my covenant. Notice the present tense. That is what God says after Noah left the ark. Next, in verse 17, this is the sign of the covenant I have established. Notice the past tense, established. This is what God says at the conclusion of our Bible reading. Whether it is the past, the present, or the future, the point is God makes a covenant with Noah. Friends, good news for sinners. There is a good news for sinners here. Your sin, no matter what it is, has already been judged. 2,000 years ago when Jesus died on the cross for you. And it is no coincidence that when John saw the vision of heaven in Revelation, he saw a rainbow encircling the throne of God. This symbolizes the completeness of God's mercy. The blood of Jesus has transformed the throne of God from a throne of judgment into a throne of mercy. So, the rainbow promise guarantees that God's mercy is for you and for all of us who labor under heavy burdens and deep personal sorrows. Friend, look up. You will see the rainbow, the sign that God has not forgotten you. So here is our second principle. God can be trusted to keep his promises. God can be trusted to keep his promises. So, dear beloved in Christ, from beginning to end, this passage is about God speaks, God establishes, God remembers. God promises to put up with a sinful man, that he loves us and cares for us. That is the message we see and hear in God's covenant with Noah. Finally, look at the rainbow and let it remind each of us this evening that there must be a judgment. So, how different should our lives look as we await its arrival? How different? For example, think about how different we are living our lives right now because of the coronavirus that causes sickness and has made many people fearful. We know this virus is imminent, so we changed our lifestyles and we changed everything in expectations of it. Friends, we must do the same regarding the coming judgment of God. Be strong. God has provided an ark of refuge for you. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this great passage. Lord, we thank you for your promises to Noah. And we all taste the benefits of these promises. We know that we are undeserved. But Lord, we thank you for the sign of the covenant to reassure us our weak faith. Lord, help us to appropriate those promises by faith, to trust in our word, to be conformed into your image by sealing of thy Holy Spirit. This we ask it in the precious name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Thank you, friends. Class has been dismissed. We'll meet next week.